Look at her. She's perfect.
Wow. Oh, my baby.
Well done.
Where have you been?
It's so
bad. Shut up. It's
Willow.
When we look at a baby, you can't help but wonder
what is going on inside.
Where does its personality come from?
How do they become who they are?
As a scientist and a new parent, I realized that babies are born totally helpless. But they're going to grow up to be masters of the universe. How does that happen?
What's exciting right now is we have so many new ways to answer those questions.
We realize now that even the very youngest babies already know more and learn more than we ever would have thought possible.
I'm gonna forget about that.
Isn't it amazing that the answer to what it means to be a human lies in the smallest, youngest creatures?
Cheeky boy.
Our babies.
Mummy's gonna be happy to see you. Which way?
Hello.
Who's that?
Hello.
Can you give your mummy a hug?
Oh, hello, darling. Haven't seen you for ages. Where's the bib? Who's that? It's Willow.
Are you going to show Willow what you bought her?
What have you bought Willow? What's in there?
Are you going to give it to Willow?
Oh.
Good girl.
Oh, that's very kind.
Good girl.
Oh.
Who's this? Gentle.
Oh. It's your sister. Give her a kiss.
The relationship with our parents is the most meaningful experience. It has such a huge impact on how a baby develops and experiences the world. I was 22 when Esteem, my oldest daughter, was born. She was placed on my chest. And I think at that moment I felt what it means to love. And being a scientist, I wanted to understand what's happening in the brain when we fall in love with our babies. What is the biology of bonding? back in the early 90s, we didn't have a full understanding of how the bonding between mother and baby develops. In my research, I came across several scientific papers that described the importance of the hormone oxytocin to bonding in mammals. That really opened my eyes. So I wondered if oxytocin would be involved in the bonding I experienced with my own children. In 2001, we started the first study to test the role of oxytocin in parent-infant bonding.
Boker tov. Bo tishachek im ima. Tadaber im ima.
Yum, yum.
This was a real adventure. We recruited about 80 mothers, and we traveled up and down the country to collect the samples throughout pregnancy and in the first month after childbirth. And what we found was that oxytocin level in mothers rise during pregnancy and they stay high throughout pregnancy and right after childbirth.
Yum, yum.
At the honeymoon.
What we also realized that when mother and infant touch each other a lot, the oxytocin levels in both go higher, and this makes you want to engage with the baby more. The brain gives the mother the sense of intense reward. So the higher the oxytocin the mother had, the more she bonded with her infant. But I always knew that this is only half of the equation.
Give me a kiss.
I began to wonder what's going on with fathers.
See how red they are. Did you know you're 4 months old today?
Yeah.
That's better. That looks so much better.
You daddy's here alone. Oh, that's a good pince. Have you been practicing? The tiger did. Yeah. That's it. That's it.
She's walking on her own. Good girl.
Dakota, you're getting so big on me so fast. Mommy doesn't want you to grow just yet. Slow down. Slow down.
As soon as she came out, it was just like, oh, this is my baby.
Look.
She's so precious, and it was instant love connection. A love that you've never experienced before.
Yeah, this is better. Especially when she lays her head sideways, I know that's when she's going to sleep. That she's not moving, she's not trying to climb no more. She's getting real comfortable. But this is me and Dakota's thing right here. Just on my shoulder, walking back and forth. Once she relaxes her arm, then I know, okay, no matter what I do, I'm gonna get at least a half an hour in.
For the next study, we wanted to see if there's an impact on the level of oxytocin in fathers.
So this is our lab. I'm gonna ask you
to spit into these tubes, about 1 milliliter.
So we recruited 80 couples. And we measured oxytocin in fathers in the first months, right after the child's birth.
Right, thank you.
And when we looked at the results, it was really shocking. Mothers and fathers' level of oxytocin were identical. And that was a huge surprise. We know for over 100 years that mothers get a surge of oxytocin during pregnancy, childbirth, and nursing. But how do fathers get so much oxytocin? We discovered that the more you do with a baby, and really lift your sleeves and take care of the child and wash it and feed it, engage in a parental role, the more your oxytocin system will activate. And this is amazing. Fatherhood is biological. It's as deep as motherhood.
Okay. Don't open it all the way.
Goes to the back of one of these?
Yeah. Look, you see that other box at the other end? That's the actual pump down there.
I had always been planning on going back to work.
Her pediatrician yesterday informed us that to spread out the feedings every 2 to 3 hours and just try to find another way to comfort her and console her, and also to give her time to allow her to self-soothe. So that way we're not, you know, just using me all the time. Because then I'll never be able to go to work. I'm not looking forward to pumping, even though I want you to feed her. But it's just like a bittersweet new chapter.
If you want me to try it before I go to your, the real one, make sure it's good.
Well, go ahead and take one for the team then.
Excuse the six pack.
Let me see.
Oh, it is doing her. Oh, wait, hold up.
Let me see.
Hold up. Hold up.
Daddy's gonna burp you. You should probably be ready for a nap.
Me too.
What? Dakota, I want you to still want milk from mommy, too. Can you do both? Can we make a deal? Yeah?
So the time is now 12:25 a.m. and Dakota has decided to use me as a pacifier. And she won't really sleep. And Sean is snoring away like a little baby. Sleeping peacefully. While Dakota and I nurse away.
We all know that when the baby cries at night, it's usually the mom that hears it. And maybe the dad will get up, change the baby. But it's the mother who is not able to sleep. When we looked at mom's brain, we found that the oxytocin surge at birth activates a very primitive structure, the amygdala.
This is the amygdala. You see it in both sides of the brain. It makes us vigilant. It makes us worry about the infant. And once the mother's amygdala is open, it stays like this forever, no matter how old your child is. When we look at Dad's brain, we saw quite a different story. It's about a quarter of what you see in mothers. But not every family has a mother.
I've been a parent for the past 11 hours. And this is the other parent.
I'm so tired. He's the most beautiful boy in the world and the universe. Oh.
He's been a good boy tonight.
Yeah. Having him in my arms and feed him, I don't know how to say. It was like love at first sight, but it's this kind of love that you know that no matter what, it will never end. It's impossible to describe with words what we are feeling.
Hi, baby.
Who's changing you? Who is that, DJ?
We started exploring surrogacy in the UK, and we learned about the option of going for surrogacy in Canada, because in Canada, you just put your case up for any woman that wants to carry your baby, and they actually are the ones that choose you. The whole story changes from the very beginning.
What is it?
The umbilical cord is down now. He has a belly button.
He has a belly button.
Oh.
In Canada, it is illegal to get paid for surrogacy. But I think that because of how intimate surrogacy is, money cannot be the reason to do this. And I wanted to help. I can't do much, but this is something that I can do.
Those baby noises when they're eating, when they're like...
Tonight at 5, he was like...
AJ gave us the ultimate gift of being able to form a family. Now she's part of our family. Her family is part of our family as well, and she will forever be.
Father and son, both of them, baby. So cute.
In 2010, we recruited a unique group of parents where there was no mother. We had 48 gay couples who were living in a partnered, committed relationship and had a child through surrogacy and had the baby from the first day of life. We videotaped in the home, baby interacting with the parents. And we took it to the lab to code it. We also measured oxytocin levels. And we scanned father's brain. And when we analyzed the results, we were in for a big surprise. Father's our primary caregiver. They had amygdala activation just like mothers. We had no idea that we would find that.
Looks like a hungry duck. 1, 2, 3.
Pregnancy, childbirth, and nursing activate the maternal brain. But also it's activated to the same extent by committed caregiving. So it doesn't really matter whether you are the biological parent or a committed caregiving parent. It's a choice. It's a choice to be a parent to that infant.
So I'm taking Eric to get his vaccines. I'm just a little bit worried because everybody told me they hurt, but I'm trying to push that down. Hi. Nice to meet you.
Nice meeting you.
I'll take you through everything now. You have to know what is going to happen after we've given the vaccines. When
you
the
are seeing my face already.
Okay.
I don't know who is going to suffer more. Yeah, more me.
Oh, really?
I'm already suffering. Oh. I hate injections.
Turn a little bit to that side for me. I need to get into these muscles. Here.
Okay.
Okay? Sorry.
I'm really sorry, my love. It's okay, my love. It's okay. Well done. All the time, I'm worried about Eric. You know, probably more than I should. It's okay. Every sound that he's making, I was all the time waking up to check what's happening. He is my baby, you know?
Well done. We're done.
Having Eric made our lives more stressful, but it's a good stress.
I came to the psychology department at Harvard University in 1968. Back then, everyone was doing hard science studies, visual perception, learning, memory. But I was really interested in what's going on between mothers and their infants. And that had never really been looked at before. I actually had one of my professors put his hand around my shoulder and say, "This emotion stuff is not what you want to be doing." And somehow I resisted that because I wanted to ask, is the baby born ready to engage in social relationships? Or is the baby just sort of passive? This led me to the development of the still face experiment. We had mothers playing with young babies, 3, 4, 5 months of age. And if the infant got really excited, the mother got really excited. Then we asked mothers to stop reacting to the baby for about 2 minutes to see what the baby would do. The babies immediately picked up that the mother wasn't reacting the way she typically did. They would smile at her. Eventually, the babies might cry, but they would keep on trying to get back into relationship. It was clear that the baby is born with the capacity to engage in social interaction. It's something that's built in and critical to us. And if a relationship gets disrupted, it has a very powerful emotional effect. Be it a baby or an adult.
I'm sorry, Willa.
just been out with the two of them. And now both are crying in the back of the car and I can't do anything about it. Not far now.
Stressful for mommy.
She was foaming at the mouth. She was crying so much.
You forgive me. You forgive me.
You're looking at your mummy.
That was horrible. What a rubbish end to a nice little afternoon, eh? Are we friends again? Do you forgive me for letting you cry? I didn't have a choice, darling. Oh, I'm sorry. Silly car. You've got a nice little bath. Having water on your head. Hair, it gets greasy really quickly as a baby. Yeah?
Is that nice?
Okay.
Hi. You made it just fine. Yeah.
Stress is inevitable. You really can't avoid it.
Just.
So does a good relationship between the parent and a baby help the baby cope with stress?
Hey, huh? Nice to meet you.
Hi. Smiling. You're smiling.
You can see just these little eyes.
Nice to meet you.
What? We have set up a new way to use the still face experiment, where we look at the amount of stress that the infant experiences.
You say hi.
Hi, sweetie.
Say hi, Ed.
Thank you so much for coming in and helping us. So we will take several measures of you and your baby.
The first thing we do is we take a sample of the baby's saliva and look at the level of a stress hormone called cortisol. The higher the level of cortisol, the greater the level of stress for the infant.
Okay, let's go to the other room.
Okay, just keep this around you for a bit, okay. You can start playing, and I will tell you when to do the still face.
Uh-oh, I'm stuck. You got me.
The still face experiment helps us to see what goes on in regular interactions between the mother and the baby.
Shall we do wheels on the bus?
The wheels on the bus go round and round.
What we see there is that they're matching one another. They're dancing, coordinated.
All through town. Mm-hmm. 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 Mm-hmm.
Have her do the still face.
Please start the still face. Remember, no touching, no talking, and sit back in your chair.
As soon as we start, the baby sees something has changed. They know it right away. Babies try to elicit her response. They may start to fuss, even cry, when she's not responding.
She's complaining a lot.
There you go. But eventually, they bring their hands up to their mouth and comfort themselves.
Okay,
Great job, thank you. You can start playing again.
Okay, going back to the piggy.
She's complaining. What did you do to me?
And it doesn't take long for the baby and the mother to figure out ways to reconnect after the stress of the still face experiment.
I read it. Oh, you get me.
And that's really important for the infant. It means that the infant is able to trust this person to fix, to repair after something has gone wrong in the interaction. When we look at the level of cortisol during the experiment, we find that where an infant has positive experience with their parents, the infant is less stressed during the still phase and shows lower levels of the stress hormone cortisol.
Okay, thank you. We are coming in.
It's really a pretty amazing finding, and it speaks to the effect of parenting on how the infant will be in the world.
What's wrong?
Every parent struggles to find out, what does my baby need now? But if you keep on trying, you'll find out the answers. Trust your baby to tell you what it is that he or she needs, and trust your own instincts about how to be responding. That's how the two of you fall in love with one another.
Mommy's coming.
All right, it's gonna be a bit different.
Oh, probably needs her diaper changed, and it's just crazy. It just doesn't feel good, especially because she's fussy over there now. I want to like hold her and, you know, talk to her. But at the same time, I have to prepare for the showings tomorrow.
I know it won't always be like that every day. So like,
oh. Aww. This is the last one. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Mommy is coming. What address was this one? I think it was Liberty. It's very, very, very difficult. And it's like, it's hard for me just as much as it is for her.
And you have feelings that she just can't experience yet, like guilt. Your little chunky cheeks. I'm giving you the strong pat, that's why, Dilly. You like the strong pats.
Hi, you know, I'm gonna let you guys do it. Come here. Hi. Hi. Here I am. Hi. Yeah. Say hi, Mommy. Did you want to tell me a story? Yeah? Did it? And what else? Really? Is that what happened? Were you giving Daddy a hard time? Yeah? That's your job, right? We gotta give him a run for his money. Yeah.
Is this the first time you guys have done it without me? Because have you done it at camp?
Yeah.
I forget. I'm not sure.
I think he did.
As a parent, I'm faced with constant dilemmas every day.
I really want my children to be adventurous and courageous, but I also really want to keep them safe.
Patricia, yours is on, right?
These are real choices. So I've wondered, what kind of impact can these parenting choices have on the baby's development? A newborn's brain is developing quite rapidly in early life. I wanted to design a study that would allow us to look at if parenting would affect the infant's brain during this unique period of life. When we first started looking at this, to my knowledge, there wasn't much on just differences in parenting and the infant's brain. So we really needed scans of babies' brains right after they were born, before they'd experienced really any parenting styles. And then fortunately, we had this great opportunity to take advantage of a much larger study, the Growing Up in Singapore Towards Healthy Outcomes study. In this study, these babies had already been scanned within the first few weeks of life. So we had a sort of baseline for brain development. We needed to follow those babies to 6 months, take another scan of their brain, and also observe differences in parenting style.
Hello.
Hi.
I'm Anne. I'm one of the guest scientists.
Nice to meet you.
This is
Daniel.
Hi, Nathaniel.
So we brought in the moms and babies when the babies were 6 months of age, and we observed the parenting behavior in the laboratory.
Go down on the mat.
What I'm really looking at is how attentive and responsive is a parent to the infant's signals.
Hello, how are you today? Are you having fun?
We had 20 babies, and we rated the mother's behavior using a system of descriptive cards. Do they respond to what the infant is doing? Oops. So, for example, we might see a baby cry. Does the mother quickly offer comfort? If the baby is reaching for something, does she let the child choose, or does she choose? These interactions are really small, and sometimes they're really quick. But over time, they add together to complete a picture of what the relationship is like.
This is him. Hello? Good morning, so you're up. No, you're gonna go straight to the property? I know, I'm gonna text you the address. Okay, perfect. Okay, bye-bye. Bless you. Bless you.
Okay. Destiny is finding it really hard because she's really motivated to go back to work. But I feel like she don't want to be any minute away from Dakota. I guess it's the motherly instincts kicking in.
Come here, we need you to be a little bit more still. I feel like I know what I'm doing, but I'm like real confident with doing this now.
Yeah, it's time for you to eat. Come on. But it's time for you to eat.
Dakota definitely knows who I am. I feel like, you know, nothing could break our bond. It's almost make me feel real soft inside, like real mushy, and I don't know, like getting real deep into my emotions, which I don't like doing, but she brings that out of me easily.
Can I get one burp? Huh?
So I just need to ask you a few questions before we proceed with the MRI. Yep. There's no radiation involved, so that's why we can do it on children.
Yeah.
All right.
Ready?
Ready.
We had looked to see differences in parenting style. Now we needed to see how do these parenting styles affect areas of the infant's brain. And to do that, we needed to take the babies back into the MRI for their 6-month scan. It's really hard to scan a baby because for a successful scan, you need to stay still. And that's not something that comes naturally to infants. So to make it easier, babies are fed before so they fall asleep.
Let's start a scan.
Is the baby sleeping?
Yeah.
Okay. There it is.
Yes, coming up.
Hi. It's coming right up. Are you okay with the image quality of this?
Yes.
Perfect. I went to my colleague Anchi Chu, an expert in neuroimaging whose team processed the data. I was really excited to see what she had found.
Here's actually the structural image. And now you can see a red dot showing up.
That's
where the hippocampus is.
So this is just one baby though, right?
Yes, it is. But if you look at all the scans we have, you look at individuals, and they have a very similar pattern.
This was really quite incredible. The hippocampus, this area towards the middle of the brain, that differed according to parenting styles. The infants who had received less responsive caregiving, their hippocampi were a bit bigger. This was surprising because the hippocampus is really important to learning and to managing distress. So what it suggests is that the babies were having to manage their own stress because they're not getting quite as much support from their parents. Even at 6 months, these everyday differences in parenting were actually linked to observable differences in the structure of the infant brain.
Hey, good job.
To my knowledge, that was the first time a group had seen this. When a parent is attentive and responsive, the baby is learning that the world is a safe place, and that frees up time for them to explore their environment. When a baby doesn't get those same signals from the parent, the baby may need to prioritize thinking about safety and comfort rather than exploration. I'm the last person to say that parenting is easy. None of us do this perfectly. What is important is that the overall experience that the child is receiving is one of attentive and responsive care. And I think for parents, that's reassuring.
Itsy bitsy spider climbed up the water spout.
down came the rain and washed the spider off. Up came the sun and dried up all the rain. The itsy bitsy spider climbed up the spout again. Yay!
Mommy missed you, Dakota.
I'm comfortable leaving. And so it just gives me a lot of hope. It gives me a lot of hope.
Come on, Dakota, come get mommy.
I think we're gonna make good parents, but there is a lot of stuff that you learn on the way.
Hi.
It's not just her being a baby now. She's a real part of our family. And she's growing into her own person.
Babies are the ultimate mystery. They're much more complex than we ever thought.
Papa.
Papa. Good boy.
How do they learn language?
Why are they sleeping so much?
How is it that babies learn to crawl? And what do they learn when they're crawling around in the world?
One of the great puzzles is, what's it like to be a baby?